What's up, guys? It's Blue TTCG back with another Vanguard deck profile, this time for Premium. This is going to be a Silverthorn Premium deck profile. Specifically, this build of Silverthorn is going to be for the Goemon combo that I showed in part three, I think it was, part two, probably, of my Silverthorn combo tutorial. If you haven't already watched that, make sure to do so. Link for that will be in the description. I know it's been a while since I've last uploaded a video, but I'm all settled with moving and stuff, so I'm back with some more Vanguard videos, and I'll continue to be uploading some content on this channel in the coming weeks and days and such, so look forward to those, guys. Let's get right into this. We're going to start with the starter. Of course, we've got Silverthorn Beast Tamer Emile. This hasn't changed with most of my builds. This card is a very good starter. It allows you to build your soul basically from turn one, and also, also make sure that your deck is a lot more consistent and filtered out, because you're able to see triggers more easily by the time you get to the late game, where a lot of your deck is filtered out of Silverthorns and basically going to be very dense with those triggers. So this card's fantastic. You want to make sure to run it as a starter so you can get all those things I just mentioned. Now for the trigger lineup and other grade zeros, we've got four copies of Nightmare Doll Lindy. This is the Heal Guardian. I know in the previous Silverthorn videos I was running Candy Clown. That was more so because I didn't have any copies of the Heal Guardian. I hadn't obtained it when it was at a good price. Now it's been reprinted, of course. It's been a lot easier to get my hands on. So anyway, this was always probably the best option for any Pale Moon deck in Premium. There's some reason to run Candy Clown or any other 20k heal trigger that you 20k shield heal trigger that you'd like. But the Heal Guardian is very important for surviving the early game. A lot of decks have strong grade 3 turns and you need to be able to defend yourself when you're on grade 2 so that you'll have a powerful enough stride turn, especially since you don't want to have low cards in your hand, which this allows you to counteract that, because you know you're getting yourself to a base power of around 19k. So very useful in terms of reducing the cards you need to burn through in order to save yourself from dying on their first grade 3 turn. That way you're able to get a lot more impactful of a first stride. And in this deck, the first stride is very important because in many cases, you won't be able to kill on the first stride with this deck. In fact, it's probably not till the second stride you'll be able to kill, just because it's hard to get all those combo pieces needed for the Goemon combo by the first stride. So first stride is when you'll be going typically for Dark Lord Princess into Yvette, and then second stride is when you'll go for the Mystique Lugia to facilitate the Goemon combo. So again, you need this in order to live throughout the early phases of the game. Next up, we've got four copies of the Draw PG, Hades Hypnotist. This card is pretty standard. Again, I've explained a lot about it before in previous Silverthorn deck profiles. Again, very important for getting a PG on a draw triggered, which saves some deck space, as well as allows you to guard with it from soul when you use it with Wandering Dragon, because it does not specify that it has to be placed from hand in order to get the PG effect. Otherwise, not really much else to say about it, other than what I've already mentioned in the past. Alright, and then we've got four copies of Silverthorn Assistant Dixie. Dixie is, I think, the best card in the deck still. This hasn't changed really for Silverthorn. This card is very important for allowing you to build your board from as few cards from hand as possible. Just because this card allows you to do all of that without using up a counterblast itself. And the fact that it goes back to the deck allows you to, again, get your deck filled with a lot of triggers, which makes Emile a lot more powerful, which is our starter, of course. Even though this is a 5k trigger, it's not a huge deal. This card is just incredible, amazing. I think this is one of those things that it's worth having, despite it being a 5k trigger. So yeah, that's all about Dixie, pretty much. Again, if you guys aren't as familiar with this card, feel free to check out my previous Silverthorn deck profiles, where I go over it in more detail. And then we've got three copies of Prankster Girl Mirrorland and one copy of Overtrigger to round out our trigger lineup. So I'll explain the Overtrigger first, because this card, I think, should not be run in place of whatever it's called. I don't remember the name of it. I think it's Galmage Held or something. The Dark States Overtrigger. That Overtrigger is way better. I just don't have it. I'm not a huge fan of Overtriggers, and I'm not willing to invest the money into them should they get banned in the near future. Of course, now that we've you know, gone through multiple ban lists with people complaining heavily about overtriggers, and Bushiroad seems to not have budged. I guess we're going to be seeing these overtriggers in the long haul, so you just got to deal with it, play around it, all that. Me personally, I'm not willing to play into that, so that's why I've got Obaria still. But again, if you have Galmage Held, feel free to use it. In fact, I believe Galmage Held is getting reprinted very soon in an upcoming set, so that's probably when I'll pick mine up. But for now, I'm sticking with Obaria. Of course, Darkstage Trigger is much better. And then we've got three copies of Pranksicle Mirrorland. This card is in this deck not because it's a stand trigger. The stand trigger, although, is, you know, a nice bonus, but the main reason we're running it is because of all the combo pieces that don't have Silverthorn archetyping. We need some way to generically put the necessary combo pieces into the soul. Now, unfortunately, this is a GB1 card, which means that oftentimes it's a dead card in your hand. And the fact that sometimes you might have to guard with it, and once it goes to the drop zone, you know, you're not going to see it again. There's no way to recur that in this deck. So it's a little unfortunate, but again, I feel like a card that's necessary to run. You can run it at two copies if you'd like, if you feel like the GB1 is a lot restricting. You know, again, a lot of times it's a dead card until that phase of the game. But when it's good, it's incredibly good. And this card especially is very good with the new G-Guardian that we got, Flexion Chimera. We're going to use that card in order to put this card into the soul's cost, and then, you know, we get to put an opponent's rear guard into the soul that stood. The opponent has to choose it, of course, sadly. But regardless, this ability triggers off of that cost of Flexion Chimera, which allows us to search basically any card in our deck, put it into the soul, and then this card goes back to the deck. In this case, we'll be usually putting either Goemon or, you know, the high priority here is Cat Knight and High Boots, just because we have only one copy of that in the deck, and that card's extremely important for allowing us to call the Goemon out from soul subsequently after we stride. But again, I like running this card in this deck. The stand trigger, again, not really necessary, but it's a nice bonus to have. I wish it were on a crit, for example, but I don't mind that it's a stand trigger personally. Now, the fact that it is a stand trigger does mean that if you happen to attack with an upright line first, of course, your upright line is going to have a two or more guard restrict as well as your other attacks during that turn. And that means you'll be able to potentially swing with that upright line twice if you happen to pull the stand trigger on your drive check. So there is somewhat of a reason to change your attack pattern for this kind of card if you feel like you're going to pull it on your drive check, which again is not too unlikely because of all the deck filtering that we'll accomplish by the time we get to that phase of the game. So that's going to do it for the triggers. Let's go ahead and finish off the grade zeros that we're running. The auxiliary grade zeros that we're running. I was going to say auxiliary. I don't know if that's a word. So here, as you see, we've got two copies of Silverthorn Beast Tamer Lalutte and one copy of Cat Knight and High Boots. So Lalutte, again, staple for Silverthorn. Incredible card. This is probably one of the, again, cards that age super well for Silverthorn and Jira, despite all that they went through, which, you know, again, Silverthorn got very poor support during that time frame. But this is one of the cards that kind of withstood the test of time, and it's proved to be very useful in its role. But we're not running it as a starter just because we have some ways to search it involving Lillian and other cards. But at the same time, it would be nice if we were to have both Emil and Lalutte guaranteed in our soul at the start of the game. That would just make things a lot easier, but we just have to live with this. So we're running the two Lalutte just in case one goes to the damage zone, for example. We'll still have the other one in our deck available to pull out with Lillian. And of course, if you have this in your hand, you can also put it into the soul with Flexion Chimera, although hopefully you would have had Lalutte in the soul before then, because that would be pretty late of a time to get Lalutte in the soul, I would say. And then finally, we've got one copy of Cat Knight High Boots. Now, notice that this is not our starting Vanguard either. This is because this card is only being used for the Goemon combo specifically, just so that we're able to pull Goemon out of the soul when we stride, because otherwise we can't do that. Sadly, Silverthorn has a lot of archetype-specific skills, which means that we cannot generically pull out Goemon from the soul without having it in our hand already, or, you know, by some other means that probably involves, like, a Hari engine or whatever you might have alternatively. So, but this card is still amazing, despite those restrictions. Of course, it's GB1, but it is a free, basically, +2 when we stride, so still very useful, and that +2 happens to fulfill entirely the cost for Mystique Lukie when we get into that. So that means we can just, you know, put these, like, we call out Goemon, or not Goemon, we call out Cat Knight High Boots. We use Cat Knight High Boots skill to call out Goemon. Let me get Goemon here. So these are in your soul, you call out Goemon, and then you put these back into the soul. And then fulfill Mystique Lucia's skill. And then, of course, Gomen, because it was put into Soul by the Vanguard's ability, you get to get its skill off by counterblasting one, and that guard ship becomes online. So, Cat 9 and High Boots, amazing for this deck, but sadly, as a one of, that means that if it goes into the damage zone, we're in quite the trouble. But it's not the worst. It's not the worst sometimes, just because having Gomen in your hand is still fine. If you're pulling out the combo, that just means you have to call Gomen. Normal call Gomen from your hand. So unfortunate, but again, you know, that's just the nature of what we're running here. It's not exactly something that was intended with these cards, I'd imagine. So that's why we have to kind of go through hoops and hurdles in order to accomplish this. And perhaps that would mean that this build isn't the best way of making use of Silver Thorn's strengths. But again, I just wanted to show off that the deck profile that I know some of you recommended or requested in that video. So, you know, just following through with that, you guys. All right, so it's the grade ones. We go. We have four copies of Arena to start off. This is probably no surprise once again. This card is just, you know, your main ride target for grade one, as well as it's being able to fill your soul in later stages of the game when you call it from your hand. Now, unfortunately, this card does kind of suffer from being not so useful after the grade one ride, but because it's 10k shield, at least you do have it as a kind of as a go-to card for, you know, guarding and such, because you won't be using it for much else. That's really all there is to say about it. Again, I feel like there's not much to say about this card in particular, as well as the fact that I've covered it quite a bit in previous videos. Similar thing about three copies of Silverthorn Beast Tamer Ana. This card, again, is, you know, it's okay, I guess. It's not the worst, but it's also just not the best, but we have to live with what we have. And if you don't happen to get Lalut, if you don't happen to get Lalut as early as you know, you would like, then this will give you early counter charges to kind of counterbalance that, but it's still good to have Lalut at some stage of the game. Now, keep in mind that if you ride this instead of Irina, then you'll be able to ride into Lillian, hopefully, and then get that free card from deck to soul, which would hopefully be Lalut in that regard. So this is still a useful ride target over Irina in a lot of cases, but again, it just depends on how you feel your opponent might manage your own damage. And you know, if they play the long game with you, that's kind of favorable for us anyway, just because this deck's a little bit slower in accomplishing its cool combo, at least slower with respect to the current meta. You know, the meta since Premium Collection 2022 is pretty fast now, so you know, the first ride plays usually can end the game potentially, and this deck doesn't have the greatest of hand sizes, so you do have to keep that in mind. But if your opponent decides to kind of manage your damage for you, then, you know, definitely, you know, cooperate with them in that regard, because I don't think this deck needs to, you know, speed up its game in order to kill the opponent. I mean, the whole purpose of having a guard restrict like Gomen is that it'll be later into the game, and you want them to be able to guard it. You want them to guard everything, because that's what really, like, kills their hand. You don't want it to be like, oh, you haven't really, you know, dealt damage that much, and then they just take everything when you go for Gomen. Or it's like early in the game where they're maybe at one damage or two damage, you go for the Gomen combo on your first stride, and they end up just taking, like, most, for the most part, everything, and you've wasted a number of attacks that could have been guarded with two or more cards from hand. So again, you know, it's favorable for us to still get this on the second stride, which is why, again, I think Ana is still useful, because it allows us to save some counterblasts until that phase of the game. Okay, four copies of Zelma are up next. This is upped from three copies. I just felt like it's good to have that high roll of three Zelma in rotation, which is kind of really the skill ceiling of the card. Right? It's a skill ceiling. That's the ceiling of the card, in my opinion, of having three in rotation. So the fourth copy is to make sure that in case one gets the damage zone, we're still able to get the high roll of three copies. But two copies is still pretty good, so for all intents and purposes, you'd like to see this in your soul, at least by your grade three turn. Grade two is, you know, kind of early, but you don't really need it in grade two turn. But grade three turn, ideally, and hopefully by your first try as well, would be ideal as well. This card is just phenomenal, and I think is really aged well in terms of the older Silverthorn cards from before G era. And then, last but not least, we've got one copy of Silverthorn Clown Cerne and two copies of Desire Devil Gomen. So, of course, the rightmost card being the star of the deck and the leftmost card being one of the supporting cast members. So, Serenade is used usually for our first drive plays when we might go into Darkla Princess Yvette or Darkla Princess into Hari, just because this card allows you to reset a column if you'd like, or, you know, effectively set up your soul for the end of turn procedure, which involves Dorian and Lalut. So, again, Serenade useful in that regard, but only at one copy here, just because I realized that two copies is kind of redundant. You know, that two copies was more so just in case, potentially, you know, Serenade went to the Damned Zone and, you know, then you wouldn't have Serenade for the rest of the game. But honestly, Serenade is not a huge deal to miss out on because it's not a vital combo piece. It's just really nice to have, especially on that Goemon Guard Restrict turn. Speaking of which, two copies of Goemon. Of course, the two copies are necessary for this card because it's the cornerstone of the deck. You know, you don't want it to go to the Damage Zone and then your combo's gone. So we have the two copies just in case one does go to the Damage Zone or something like that, and we have the other one to fall back on. So only one is needed, though, because hopefully if we have Cat 9 High Boots in our soul, anytime we stride, we'll be able to pull both of them out and go from there, basically, you know, with our Mystique Luke Guard Restrict, etc. This card is not something you really want to see early game. Although, if you happen to have it in your hand and you're going second against a deck that could, you know, potentially rush you a little bit early game, then it's nice to have that 8k base that it does have. But again, you know, not 100% necessary. I'd say it's better to just, you know, find it organically later into the game, maybe with Prankster Girl Mirland, or by, you know, or you know, you just have it in your hand already, and you put it into the soul directly with, like, Flexion Chimera or something. So that those are all options in order to get into the soul. But again, we're mainly going to be wanting to see this when we need to see it, not really earlier than that. So, but yeah, that's about it for the grade ones. Let's go ahead and go into the grade twos now. Starting off with four copies of Silverthorn Marionette Lillian. Again, I think this card doesn't really need too much explanation. It's really just such a good card for Silverthorn. Searches pretty much any Silverthorn card and puts it in your soul. That's about as good as it needs to be. And it happens to also be a 19k beat stick when you have four more different names of Silverthorn in your soul. Very easy to fulfill, even around like your grade 3 turn, or grade 2 turn, in fact, because of Emil as our starter. So Lillian just flat out fantastic card. I don't think there's much more to be said about her. And then we've got three copies of Upright Lion, Silverthorn Upright Lion. This card is, you know, I'd say... the ratio can be like 4 or 3. It can even be 2 if you'd like. To be honest, like, since we're running the Guard Restrict variant of this build, I don't know if Upright Lion is 100% needed. You know, to be like, it's not like a vital component of the deck, and you know, compared to non Goemon Guard Restrict builds. Although there is another build of, excuse me, there is another build of Silverthorn that I use currently that involves, you know, Lantina as the front focus card, and in that build you definitely need the Upright Lions. But for this build, you know, because of the Guard Restrict being applied for the entire turn and not just after your Vanguard attacks, I think this card is probably fine to run at fewer copies. But again, important to use this for our stacks, because basically we do our normal Goemon combo with Mystique Luke, Selvia, etc., and Upright Lion will naturally get to high numbers, like, so might as well run it, right? Your opponent can't deal with, excuse me, sorry. If your opponent can't deal with, you know, 50k beat sticks that are two of our Guard Restricts, then that's on them. You know what I mean? So, nice to have this, you know, to force them to respect you a little bit. You know, if you guys want to see how you get those stacks for Upright Lion with this particular build, feel free to, again, check out the part 2 of the Silverthorn combo tutorials that I have from the past uploads. And finally, we've got two copies of Silverthorn Diva Selvia. So I'd say Selvia is, again, still an important card, but typically, you know, since you only need one in rotation, you can kind of get greedy with this build and probably just one run one copy, but that's a little risky, you know. The problem with that is that if it does go to the damage zone, you probably just lose, right? Like, you really need this to be in your rotation. But having two in your, like, hand plus soul or whatever at any point is just terrible. Which is why I think you probably shouldn't run it at more than two for this build, or, you know, typical premium builds. But again, this card is still very important. This allows you to build your board off of things like Dixie or Zelma, and also Venus Lucia as well. And then your strides, of course, which is very important, because when we go into Mystique Lucia, even a card like a Darkle Princess Yvette into Yvette as well, this card allows you to basically rebuild your columns and attack with more attacks and potentially, you know, threaten your opponent a little bit more. Although its purposes in that regard are a little lessened compared to just building a board with avenues, cards in your hand in general, which means that you'll be able to defend more easily, which is important for a deck like this that doesn't have that big of a hand size. Please bring Dorian back to four, please, Bushiroad. All right, grade threes. Three copies of Venus Luque. So, you know, I've been sticking to my guns on three copies of this card. You can run four if you'd like, but that means you'd have to decrease another one of the grade threes potentially, just to keep the grade three ratios, you know, at a minimum, because I think having too many grade threes is a little bricky for this kind of deck. Especially when you have cards like Lilith, which adds a grade three at the end of the turn anyway, from the soul. So obviously Venus Luque, extremely important for our grade three turns. And even beyond that, you know, being able to ride it and get a free Excel marker. In this case, we pretty much always use Excel 1 or 2. I forgot to do that at the beginning of the video, but yes, I did say Excel 1. Excel 1 is an option, I believe, for this deck. It's not something that you typically go into, but, you know, if you feel like you can't make big enough numbers going into the early game, then Excel 1 is an option compared to Excel 2, but also just depends on how much you think you can keep your hand size. Because if you go Excel 1, you'll start to notice very quickly that your hand sizes are a lot less, especially when you use Dark Lord, or when you use a Midair Megatrick Yvette as well, because she gives an Excel marker as part of her auto ability on attack. And because that Excel marker, you know, typically would give you a draw if you go for Excel 2, then you won't be getting that with Excel 1. So keep in mind that Excel 1 might dock you quite a bit if you rely a lot on the draw power that Excel 2 would have provided you. But yeah, this card is fantastic. If you don't have Dorian in rotation, then usually that second ability to suck in all the rear guards to get an Excel marker is very important to not miss out on. So just keep in mind that you have to make sure to end on a board that you can actually make use of this card to protect your circles. And also this goes for the Mystique Luque turn. When you go for the Mystique Luque Gomen turn, your board will not naturally, you know, have the protection at the end of the turn unless you have Dorian on the board, because there's no like Venus Luque auto ability in standby for resolution at the end of the turn. So just make sure to keep that in mind. All right, and then probably the more controversial part of this deck, we're running three copies of the Strive Bonus Luque and one copy of Dorian. I don't think Dorian's controversial. I won't touch too much on her other than still very important to run. Sadly, we have only one copy of this card still. I really don't know why we, you know, have to suffer like this, Silverthorn players. But alas, you know, this is what we have to live with for the foreseeable future. But again, this card is very important, so make sure to run it. And then the three copies of Strive Bonus Luque. So, you know, my main reasoning for running this is, like, the extra 3k you get for the Mystique Luque turn. Like, obviously, Mystique Luque is the card necessary for the Gomen combo. Of course, you could also do it with Masquerade Master Hari, but I feel like it's a lot better with Mystique Luque. Now, because we're running Mystique Luque for that, we might as well just run the Stride Bonus Luque just because we get the extra bonus when we stride into a G-unit with Luque in its name. So the extra 3k can come up quite a bit, actually, especially when it applies to every single Silver Throne card that you call from Soul during that turn. So that would include things that are also called to the back row. That makes a huge difference for columns, but in terms of like the actual, like impact, you know, it's up for debate. It's really up to you whether you think this is like valuable enough to run. I do think there's space to run either Luque Reverse or even, dare I say, OG Luque, even in this kind of deck, just because this card kind of has a, you know, slightly hard to slot, like uncomfortable slot in this deck, in my opinion. But the LB4 to Soul Blast 1 and bring it out at the beginning of the main phase actually like saved me quite a few times. Allows you to get some more cards on the board, potentially, to get things started. Sometimes, you know, of course, if you have Cat 9 Heavy Boots, then you might not need it, right? But if you sometimes want to go for, let's say, a Zelma from hand, then you can put that this Luque that you call from Soul at the beginning of the main phase into the Soul. And you can also just keep this on the board to use as an extra attacker, because it would be a 17k attacker if you stride Mystique Luque and you call it off of its own skill. So not too bad, I guess, but again, it really just depends on maybe the matchup and also how effective you'd feel it'd be of course, in the force matchup, you never want to do that just because, you know, 17k versus 13k base is not really a good recipe, in my opinion. Like, you know, if they just intercept, they've already avoided that, the potential for that to be dangerous. So, yeah, you know, I think this can be replaced, yes, but I personally do like the stride bonus for the Gomen turn. And I hope I've shown in the combo video, I think I did, it's been a while since I recorded that, but I showed in the combo video the benefits of having the stride bonus Lugia. So, you know, if you feel like that's something that aligns with what you'd like to do with Silverthorn, then sure, I'd say definitely go for it. All right, that's about it for the main deck, guys. Let's go ahead and go into the G-Zone. The G-Zone doesn't really have much going on with it other than the fact that we're running Mystique Lugia, which is, you know, previously an abysmal card, to say the least. But in this kind of build, it's perfect. So we'll start off with it, two copies of which we are running. So again, this, as I mentioned earlier, we're using this to facilitate the Gomen combo. And the fact that it has Lugia in its name is an extra, you know, benefit for us to leverage Stride Bonus Lugia that I talked about earlier. So fantastic card in those regards. Now keep in mind it does soul charge after the cost is paid. And the cost is, of course, choose two of your rearguards put into the soul. So it's not choose two Silver Thorns for some reason. But we take those. We're going to abuse that as much as we can for this build. But the fact that it does soul charge means that you do have to be careful with the cards that you have left in your deck. Just make sure that you're not, you know, decking out with your calculations that you made prior to the turn starting, as well as the fact that, you know, you might soul charge a lot of triggers, especially in that phase of the game, since we filtered out a lot with cards like Emile. So those are all things to keep in mind, but I think it's fantastic for this build. All right, and then two copies of Venus Lugia, the Stride version. So Venus Lugia is, I never go into it. Like, I'm going to be honest, okay? I'm running it just because it has Lugia in its name. Since we're running the Stride Bonus Lugia, I just thought, hey, we might as well just try this out since, you know, it's a free plus one off of Counterblast, and you could potentially go into further pluses if you go into a card like Selvia or whatever you might have in your soul at that point in the game. And the fact that it has an extra crit when you pay its cost on attack, you know, that could be useful for closing out the game potentially, but at the same time, it's definitely one of the more underwhelming strides that are available just in terms of opportunity cost as well, just because I think Masquerade Master Hari finishes out the game a lot more effectively than this card. But because it has Lugia name, potentially there's, you know, room to experiment with this with the extra 3k that you get from each card that you call from the soul that has Silverthorn's name from the stride bonus. So there's probably room for this card to shine, but and you know, in my opinion, it's kind of dead weight. You can definitely cut it for something else that you'd prefer, but I do have it in here as kind of, you know, a presentation of the full, you know, Silverthorn glamour, whatever the word you might use for that. Then, of course, the standard Dark Lord Princess package. One Yvette, two Dark Lord Princess herself, and two Masquerade Master Hari. You can up this to three. Actually, three is a pretty good number for this kind of card because you can flip, when you go into the second Dark Lord Princess, you can flip the other MM Hari that you haven't already used, and then just stride the face-up one from earlier, and then make sure, of course, you flip the... you don't have to flip this, you can flip anything. But when you stride the face-up MM Hari, you still have that third MM Hari in order to flip face-up for the persona, the whatever it's called, the persona flip. There we go. The persona flip of the on-attack skill. So yeah, standard Dark Lord Princess package, nothing really much to say about it. This still remains, like, stupidly, like, the best package you could run for Silverthorn. For Silverthorn, but for, like, Pale Moon in general. It's just, Dark Princess is just way too good of a card. And I feel like it's definitely outclassing a lot of the other strides that, you know, they could have printed for Pale Moon, potentially. But, you know, they didn't hit the mark because Dark Princess was so much better. I'm talking about, of course, Leontina. The fact that Leontina doesn't have Maja in its name, or in its skill, means that it kind of, you know, fall short, misses the cut for this deck. Although, of course, you can cut Venus Lugia stride for Leontina if you'd like. It's not a huge deal for that to be cut. But yeah, that's all for the Dark Princess package. Again, we're usually going into Dark Princess Yvette on our first stride, or if you want to close out the game kind of early, you can go into Dark Princess into Masquerade Master Hari. Especially useful in the Link Joker matchup. All right, and last for the strides, we've got one copy of Fairfield. So Fairfield, You know, it's again, it's another card that's fantastic for its exact use. You can think of it like, the Yu-Gi-Oh 5D's anime long ago. I'm not sure if they still do this, but back when, they have cards that are like super bad, but then in the anime they have the characters use them for this exact like perfect situation, and it makes the card seem super good. That's kind of what Fairfield is, to be honest. It's not that it's a bad card actually, but you don't often find yourself going into it. But in the exact situation where you're about to deck out, like, I think this card is fantastic. Like, this card has saved me in a number of times when its situations come up. You're able to put crits from Soul back into the deck, and then you're able to give something like an Upright Lion the ability to not be able to be chosen by card effects, as well as you give it some power and crits. Now, keep in mind, because it can't be chosen by card effects, that means it also cannot be chosen by your own triggers. So don't, you don't want to limit yourself by going into this card if you feel like that restriction is enough to thwart your plays. But the fact that it can't be chosen by card effects also means that you can dodge the deadly Denial Griffins that, often are, often spell the end for Silverthorn decks for the most part, such as, Narukami's G-Guardians, as well as, of course, the original Denial Griffin and even Grand Blue's Denial Griffin play. So all of those are definitely threats, but again, you're able to kind of telegraph them based on how many counterblasts they have available, as well as the, number of cards they have face up in the G-Zone or whatever cards they have in the field, those kinds of things. So those are all things to, look out for when you decide to pick Fairfield as your stride option. Okay, now for the G-Guardians. We're going to go through them all together. Let's do it. We got one copy of Fernival, one copy of Coulthard, two copies of the new one, Flexion Chimera, and two copies of Wandering Dragon. Okay, so Fernival is, still pretty solid. It's not the best, obviously, but, for what it does, it's pretty good. It's good enough, basically. Like, looking at the top three to get a card into the soul does allow you to put like a Prankster Girl or even just the Goemon directly into your soul. And then, of course, the rest of the bottom. And if you put a grade one or greater, this card gets just 5k shield. So the 5k shield is not really as, crucial. I guess it's just a nice way of making you feel a lot better about spending a G-Guardian or spending a heal trigger for this G-Guardian. But again, not our best option necessarily. And then Coulthard. Coulthard, I don't think this card is good at all. I mean, I'm going to be real. The best thing it does is G-flip, but honestly, like, this deck doesn't need to G-flip ever. Like, we're not really using Generation Break for much. So, yeah, I mean, unfortunate that we have a G-flip G-Guardian that is as bad as this, but, you gotta live with what you have. And this card, for what it does, I guess, 30k shield, kinda nice, but, I mean, now that we have, like, Flexion Chimera and we already had Wandering Dragon, which was, like, good enough G-Guardian, I think this card is definitely subpar. Speaking of which, we've got two copies of Flexion Chimera. So this card, I think a lot of people didn't think it was going to be that good, and I understand why they think so. I mean, the supposed Denial Griffin opportunity this card has is kind of bait. Like, I feel like the Denial Griffin effect is not very good, especially when it's played around properly. But the fact that it does get 10k shield for each card you put from hand to soul is a bit nice, especially since, again, Silverthorn doesn't have the best hand quality. So oftentimes you're just converting those, those low shield value cards from your hand, like Zelma, for example, into a 10k shield, which is very valuable. And the fact that Zelma becomes a card in soul for your rotation in the following turn, extremely important. I mean, that's amazing for Silverthorn, in my opinion. Just the fact that you're able to put cards from hand to soul makes, I think, basically every Pale Moon deck a lot better. At least, Silverthorn for sure. So, the Denial Griffin effect again, probably not the part about the effect that, we're really highlighting for this deck, but the fact that you put a card from hand to soul for the cost means that you'll be able to, again, on your opponent's turn, perhaps you drew off of a draw trigger that was damage checked, like, let's say, a Goemon. Ordinarily, that Goemon wouldn't be able to be put on the field before your stride, or, before you go into your main phase. But because we have Flexion Chimera, we can put it into the soul, and then maybe off of a Cat 9 High Boots, we're able to put it on the field again because we call Cat 9 High Boots when our Vanguard's placed, which allows us to subsequently call the Goemon. So this card is pretty good, in my opinion, I think. I think it performs its purpose pretty well. And then Wandering Dragon at 2 copies. Excuse me. This card is still pretty good. You know, the random soul shards hurts a bit, but the fact that we do get to choose the card from soul to call means that you will be able to pick the option that just has the best net shield value. Now, of course, since we're no longer running the 20k shield heal triggers, that means that you at most would get a 15k shield at a time. But, you know, you do have PGs available to call from soul if you'd like through Hades and Tis and such. So this card still can get the 25k shield, even 30k shield mark with relative ease. Now, I will say that there's probably good enough reason to run the vanilla heal triggers from V if you'd like, just to make this card feel a lot better than it actually like probably is. But again, we know we just have to live with what we have for Pale Moon in terms of G-Guardians. All right, guys, and that's going to do it for the Silverthorn Goemon variant deck profile. I hope you guys enjoyed it. I know that it's been a while since I last uploaded a video, so I did want to make sure to address some of the comments I've received between that last time and now. So future videos, upcoming videos, we'll definitely be addressing those as high priority, and then I'll get to the, you know, normal flow of content from there, and I hope to see you guys in those future videos. I hope you guys appreciated this one. If you did, please feel free to leave a like and a comment, and please subscribe to the channel as well for more Vanguard content. I'll probably also upload some Yu-Gi-Oh! Content as we go along here, but, you know, it just depends on how I'm feeling. I'm definitely getting back into Yu-Gi-Oh! A lot now that I have a recurring local scene I can go to frequently. But yeah, guys, that's going to do it. Again, thanks for watching. I hope to see you next time, and I really appreciate you guys bearing with me through this kind of long stretch of silence for me. Peace.